friends, and welcome to ABN's Trinity Channel for the first International Apologetics Marathon of 2017. We're having a great week. We've had a number of shows that have happened already, and a lot of those shows are available on the Trinity Channel's YouTube channel. Please check those out, take those URLs, and share those with your friends, family, and everyone else, because we're doing some very important shows, asking some very important questions. We have very great guests who are giving great content and answers to those vital questions that people really need to hear the answers to. And we ask all the time, what other channel can you turn to where you can actually watch shows like this, where you can actually watch international apologetics marathons, which are being broadcast to the Middle East, North Africa, Australia, and New Zealand through satellite, as well as through high-speed internet and all of the brand new platforms that we are now on, including Apple TV, Amazon Fire Stick TV, Roku, Chromecast Stick, IPTV, Smart TV, Samsung Smart TV, Android Smart TV. The list continues to grow. And as you can see, these posters behind me, we are celebrating the ABN Digital Tree, which is going ultimately going to be about 30 new channels, which are going to be about 11 in English, and then, of course, all the rest in Arabic, and a lot of channels that people can tune into to watch what they love all the time, all day and all night, if you want to. We have debates on the debate channel 24/7. We have politics. We have Jesus or Muhammad. We have a number of different shows and channels that we are now doing. And these are to better serve you, our viewers. So thank you for praying for us. Thank you for your financial support, which allows this vital work to continue. It's thousands and thousands of dollars per month, which allows us to continue to give you satellite feeds throughout the world. So please continue to support, whether it is a one-time gift, if you've never given before, or if you can sign up for a monthly pledge, we would be very appreciative of that. We thank God for you, and we love doing these shows for you that you can watch and share with other people, because there's no other channel you can turn to that is like ABN, the Trinity Channel, where we're not worried about being politically correct, but just correct in general, sharing the gospel in its entirety, and of course, defending the historic Christian faith through apologetics. Now, this show is unique because I don't think we've ever done something like this before. We've talked about women under Islam, but this is going to get even more detailed because this specific topic is going to address a lot of what we're seeing throughout the world today when you compare the East to the West. And I have a couple of great guests here with me. I'm really excited to have them on as usual. But this show is called Khadijah, Muhammad's Pre-Islamic Wife. Now, a lot of people don't know who Khadijah is, so we are definitely going to let you know about that. And it's important to know who she is because she, of course, was Muhammad's wife, but like you see in the title, pre-Islamic. And we want to let people know why that matters, especially when people are talking about women under Islam. Are they talking about Khadijah? Or are they talking about wives who Muhammad had after her? So this is going to be a very informative show because I have great guests. I want to introduce my first one. I have Beth Grove. She is born and raised on the mission field and has lived among Muslim immigrant communities in London since 1997, enjoying friendship and dialogue with close Muslim friends from many nations. After traveling through Muslim countries, she obtained a master's degree in Islamics, and she is one of the co-founders of the Fander Center for Apologetics, which is a research think tank and a teaching ministry to help equip Christians worldwide to engage Islam with a confident Christianity. Beth, it is always great to have you on, so welcome back to ABN and the Trinity Channel.
Thank you. Good to be with you, Tony.
It's great to have you here. And I have another guest as well. I have Rocky Nasser. Rocky is a speaker, evangelist, and author. She put her trust in the Lord Jesus Christ on August 2nd, 1998. Since then, she's earned a bachelor's degree in biblical studies from Criswell College and a master's of theology in evangelism and discipleship from Dallas Theological Seminary. Her testimony has been featured in Today's Christian Woman magazine, and she has contributed a chapter to a book titled Voices Behind the Veil, The World of Islam Through the Eyes of Women. She speaks at congregations, conferences, seminars, and on radio stations around the nation. Rocky, welcome back to ABN and the Trinity Channel.
Thank you for inviting me, Tony.
I'm excited to have both of these lovely ladies here because I need ladies here to be talking about Khadijah, Muhammad's pre-Islamic wife. And Rocky and Beth are a great combo. Beth, like I said, is from the Fander Center. Beth, as well as the other ladies from Fander and Jay Smith himself, are on the front lines over in the UK debating fundamentalist Muslims every day, just about, at Speaker's Corner. And they not only focus on apologetics, but also polemics. Apologetics is defending what we believe. Polemics is critiquing what other people believe. And of course, Rocky, having a degree in theology and apologetics and missions, it's just a great combo for this show. And I am really excited because I know you ladies are going to give our audience a lot of content and a lot of answers that they need to hear, because people are wondering, does the religion of Islam ennoble women, as some people claim, or is it oppressive, or is it something else? So I actually want to start off with Rocky and ask you, what are some positive things in Islam that address women, if any?
Yeah, there are a couple of things. One thing that stands out, especially to Muslims, is the fact that women, young girls, were killed at a very young age, and Islam came and forbid that. This is a very interesting topic, though, because I have been watching some videos on YouTube and on Facebook of a guy named Hamid Abdul Samad, and he is the founder of an organization called The Box of Islam. So you can find that, or you can find him on YouTube at Hamid.tv. So Basically he says, this is something very interesting that he says. He says, you know, even though there were Islam came and forbid women being killed or young girls being killed, he said, how come these Muslim men had several wives? So you look back at it, you have to think critically as to something that is said positively and what was the content behind it and how did that affect the Arabian world. And so even though Islam came and forbid that, there wasn't a whole lot of that going on, because if a lot of that was going on, then there wouldn't be a whole lot of women for these guys to marry, right? Mm-hmm. So even though that's something that was very positive, it was still, I mean, it wasn't happening a whole lot. Another story, you know, we want to talk about specific women. Another story was Khawla bint al-Azwar. And she was during the Battle of Yarmouk, and they went in, Khalid bin al-Walid went in to Syria, and he was going to conquer Syria and take over Syria, as the way they did with Islam and how they spread Islam was they would go in and they would conquer the lands and stuff. Uh-huh. Well, a lot of the women were being taken by the Byzantine Empire, and they were enslaved or they were in prisons. And so this woman, Khawla bint al-Azwar, she actually went in and she freed a lot of these women, and she encouraged these women to fight. She was a stud. I mean, she did a lot of very positive things. But I have to ask myself the question again, is did Islam encourage her to do that, or was that something that she did? I mean, there were a lot of very courageous women that existed, and you're courageous whether you're a Muslim or any type of faith. If you're a woman and you have that, you know, that fire in your belly, and Khawla seemed to have that fire in her belly, and she freed a lot of women. There's another woman, Umm Salama, and she was one of the wives of Muhammad, and she narrated about 378 hadiths of Muhammad, and she was the one who asked Muhammad, why are women not mentioned in the Quran? And so then the Quranic verses came back down, and they, you know, and he addressed the Muslims, men and women, because Arabic is very gender specific. So a lot of these women existed in Islam who were just great women. And of course, Khadijah, and I'm going to let Beth share more about that. But, you know, a lot of these women existed. But these women were courageous to begin with. It wasn't because of Islam. It was because of who they were, I believe, personally.
And as we know, when it comes to the religion of Islam and every other man-made religion out there, which is ultimately a lie, there's no Holy Spirit that indwells these people. that gives them assurance that it is true or anything like that. So it makes sense, Rocky, to think, okay, well, there's this obviously a cognitive dissonance that goes on in the minds of a lot of Muslims when they study the life of Muhammad and, okay, I'm supposed to do what he did, but at the same time, they have the law written upon their hearts and they have a conscience. And I think that kind of conflicts, not just sometimes, but probably a lot of times in the lives of certain Muslims. But Beth, Khadijah was Muhammad's his first wife, and how is her life different than Muhammad's other wives that came after Khadijah died and Muhammad became a polygamist? I'm sorry.
That's a really important question.
Go ahead.
That's a really important question. You will see a huge difference between Khadijah and what happened with her. And this is according to the Islamic text. This is not according to anything outside of Islam, but the Islamic text. You will see a big difference to what happened to Khadijah compared to Aisha, compared to Jurayra, compared to Safiya and all of his other wives. And you have to ask the question, does Khadijah represent that which came before Islam and then the other wives represent what came after? And the big question, as Rocky was talking there about looking at these some of the women that some Muslims will raise as examples for them to follow and saying that it's Islam that did this for these women. One of the things that's important to remember, when we look at the whole topic today, we're mostly reliant on Islamic texts. We're not really reliant on too much outside of Islam. Mm-hmm. The reason for that, when Islam was spreading really fast from the time, according to Islamic tradition, Muhammad came and he was marrying and he was going on his wars and then he died and then very quickly Islam spread. They were taking over lots of cities, they were taking over lots of countries as they spread right across North Africa, quickly into Spain within 100 years and of course the other way through Persia to all the way to China. Now as they went, they would conquer those nations, they would then destroy really what was in their path. And so a lot of the history, a lot of the sizes, a lot of the libraries that existed in those lands don't exist anymore, and we can only really rely on Muslim texts. And so one point I want to make at the very beginning is this, is that the stories that we know of Khadijah, the stories we know of Muhammad, whilst Muslims have to sign up to them because it's their tradition, it's in the biography of Muhammad, it's in the exegetes of the Quran, it's in the Quran itself, they sign up to that. But any of us who study history, we look at those texts and we see, how do we even know that those stories are historically reliable? So there's really two questions going on through this whole talk day. Is we look at the Islamic text, we take them at face value according to how Muslims would, and we investigate it from that perspective, and we see a real disparity between how Khadijah is and how Aisha and how Safiya and how Jurayra were treated, Muhammad's later wives. We see a real difference in the role and the status of Khadijah compared to Muhammad's other wives. But there's another question alongside that is, are even any of these stories true? Are they historically reliable? So just as a caveat at the very beginning, it would be good to say that as we go through the show today, it's important to remember that we are looking at to the traditions of Islam, and so it's all according to the traditions of Islam, which in and of themselves are troubling and disturbing. Yeah. And then if you compare it to history, well, history might well say a whole different scenario. So even the whole claim that Islam came and it eradicated infanticide, that's the killing of children, as Rocky mentioned earlier. Well, even that story, how do we know that that was really happening? How do we know it was widespread? We have the Islamic text to look to, but how do we know that's an issue? And my question is this, why is that really the main thing and really the only thing many Muslims can go to show what Islam did as far as a good thing for women or for females is the stopping of infanticide? What about women as adults? What about young girls? What about Aisha, who is the 9-year-old bride? What about the many women that Muhammad took on as slaves and his men did later on? So there's a whole lot of interesting topics to unpack here, both from the traditional Muslim point of view and also from a historical perspective, which are two different questions here.
And I definitely want to do that, and that's why I'm very happy to have both these ladies on for an hour and a half show. We could do a 3-hour show maybe if we have time, I don't know. But I know we have other things that we need to do. But that's very important for people to know, is that Muhammad had many wives, but we do need to be honest and say that Muhammad, when he was married to Khadijah, he was faithful to her. He was not a polygamist when he was married to Khadijah. But it's after Khadijah died that things changed. Now, before we get to those details, I want to ask Rocky, are there other women who are highly esteemed other than Khadijah in Islam and Islamic history?
Well, as I mentioned, Khawla bint al-Azwar is one of those women that have been highly esteemed because she was fighting during the Battle of Yarmouk during the Byzantine Empire. She, as a matter of fact, there are schools that are named after her, you know, among the Arab traditions. And again, you have to ask yourself the question, why did she have to go in there and fight these battles? And it was because the Muslim men, the Muslim world, went into Syria and tried to conquer these lands. And so it was an offensive on their part, not a defensive. And as a result of that, the women were being subjugated and the women were taken as prisoners. But again, there's nothing in the traditions, as far as the Quran is concerned or the Hadith are concerned, that encouraged her to do that or told her to do that. I think she, you know, naturally, like I mentioned earlier, she was already a woman that had a fire in her belly and she was going to take care of all the other women that were being enslaved. And then the other woman that is mentioned oftentimes is, you know, Umm Salama, who was, you know, narrated a lot of the Hadith. Now, they also esteem Khadijah, but, you know, as Beth mentioned, or Aisha, and the issue is Aisha was a very young girl. She was 6 years old when Muhammad married her, and at the age of nine, he consummated the marriage. And so I know that there's a lot of Hadith that are written through her, but at the same time, she wasn't treated very well. And as a matter of fact, there were a situation where she even challenged Muhammad's prophethood and asked him, and she said, "Do you really claim yourself to be a prophet?" At one point, and she even said, "I believe that Allah follows your desires, Muhammad." I mean, she said that to him when he was going to marry Zainab. So she saw past through all of that and addressed those issues.
Interesting. And one of the key words there that you use was conquer. And this goes back to what Beth said earlier about basically Islam moving like a tidal wave through North Africa and spreading. It obviously doesn't sound like defensive battles that were going on. And anyone who looks to Islamic history can tell that that is not the case. And Beth, as we have in the title, Khadijah, Muhammad's pre-Islamic wife, and that is exactly what she was. Why do so many Muslims still today kind of overlook all of the history between Khadijah and now and still point back to her as the role model for Islam?
Tony, because Khadijah is the only one that bears any resemblance to the kind of equality and good treatment that women have today. She was a woman of power. She was a businesswoman. She had a caravan. She was probably very wealthy. She was actually Muhammad's boss. She was much older than him. And you can imagine this young man of the desert. I mean, Muslim tradition says that Muhammad was a illiterate man, and traditions show that he came from a pagan family. And suddenly he gets a job with a very wealthy businesswoman, and she was his boss. And so in that role, he was subservient to her as someone who was employing him. And that looks like how that whole scenario, that whole marriage started out. And you can imagine if she's your boss and she's the one who's giving you your money and the one that's providing for you, you really don't go against the woman that in some sense is above you. Yeah. And so she also represented the free woman of Arabia of the time. She was most likely someone who traveled. She had a lot more freedom. We know that women in those days owned property, which after Islam came, that was really restricted compared to what happened in pre-Islamic times. There are funerary inscriptions we know from ancient times that talk about women who had a lot more free will and a lot more rights to their own belongings and so on. And so she really represented maybe the women of higher society. We don't know. But even if she just represents the women of higher society, maybe not the village women,
compare that to Muhammad's wives, because Muhammad's wives became the highest women of society. In chapter 33 of the Quran, they're considered the mother of all believers. And as the mother of all believers, then they are the ones that people look to for an example. And so they were the women of highest society. But look how they were subjugated. They were really, they were controlled. And even according to the Quran, takes Surah 66, where Allah threatens Muhammad's wives, and he threatens them and says, because they told a secret, it says in the chapter, then Allah will replace them with better wives, with matrons and with virgins. That's right there in the text of the Quran. So these are the mothers of all believers. These are the most the highest women of society. And yet Allah threatens them from heaven that they will be replaced if they don't toe the line and begin to basically obey Muhammad. And also it was simply for telling a secret. Now you have to go outside of the Quran to understand the story behind that. But nevertheless, do you see how even the highest women of society, once Muhammad came to power and Khadijah had died and Islam started to take off, the highest women of society was subjugated. So compare that to the highest women of society before Islam, and Khadijah is the woman that represents the free woman, the woman of power, the woman of equality, the woman of business before Islam came.
And she's the same woman who we need to thank, or perhaps not thank, for talking Muhammad into believing that he was a prophet in the first place. Because after he had the supposed visitation, revelation from Jibril or Gabriel, he wanted to commit suicide. And Khadijah is the one who talked him into saying, well, no, you know, you're a prophet. And she was actually the first convert to Islam. Now, it's very interesting that all this information that Beth is giving people, because that is something that we really need to understand when it comes to women today, Muslim women, especially in the West, who say that the hijab is something that you wear in order to ennoble women, and it really, you know, raises the bar for women and their role and stuff like that. There's actually a hip-hop rap group called the Dean Squad, and they have a number of different songs, and I was looking at the lyrics to these. And this is proof right here, because I saw these guys and they did a video that was released on International Women's Day, and it's featuring women wearing the hijab and saying, really, you know, it ennobles them and all that kind of stuff. But one of their older songs called Muslim Queen, this is the actual lyrics from it. I'm not going to try to rap it, but I'll say the lyrics here. It says, yo, I think I need her. Inshallah, I'll keep her. She's a righteous believer. She's my halal diva. A painting on the wall, she's my Muslim Mona Lisa. She's so good with her business, my modern day Khadijah. So these guys who live in Canada are obviously looking to Khadijah as well as their example that they're trying to relay to people of, okay, this is what Islam does for women. But their problem, just like many other people today, is that they're looking to the very beginning rather than everything that happened in between. They're just overlooking all of that information and pointing to her. So, Rocky, I want to ask you, are there examples of women who were exploited under Islam after the time of Khadijah?
Yeah, I think the biggest woman that was really exploited was Zainab bint Jahsh, and she was a woman who was the cousin of Muhammad. God supposedly sent down a verse from heaven and forced her to marry Muhammad's adopted son. And then one day Muhammad went to visit her home, and she was wearing something that was, I guess, a little bit revealing, and he was attracted to her. And when his adopted son found out about it, he basically said, I'll divorce my wife and give her to you, Muhammad. And Muhammad said, no, you keep your wife. And then there's a verse, actually, that came down. It was in 33:6 where God forced basically Zainab to get married. And then in 37, God gave Muhammad permission to actually marry her. And so that's a really huge problem. And you talked about the issue of the head covering and the covering of the bodies and so on and so forth. Actually, there's a story that, you know, Hamid, again, in his videos, which I don't want to, you know, plagiarize any of his material. And that's why I'm referencing him. And I went back to the original text to study it to make sure that it was accurate. And it is, in fact, accurate. But the story of the head covering actually was from Umar ibn al-Khattab. He was one of the friends or the Sahaba of Muhammad. And basically, he wanted women to be covered. And he went to Muhammad and said, I want women to be covered. And Muhammad said, no, I'm not going to do that. So what Umar ibn al-Khattab actually did was he would wait for Muhammad's wives in the middle of the night to go out of their homes to relieve themselves. And he would say things to them in flirtation. And so Muhammad was upset about that. And then the verses actually came down for women to cover themselves. And the reason why, the Quran clearly says it, that the reason why that the women had to cover themselves was so that they would not be attacked by other men, so that they would know that these are Muslim women that they cannot touch. So that was even the reason why the head covering. And so you can go back and say that, women were protected but they were exploited. And the reason why, you know, Muhammad allowed the head covering to begin with, or the covering of the body to begin with, was because of what Umar ibn al-Khattab did himself.
Excellent. And Beth, based on what Rocky said, as far as mentioning other women after Khadijah, other wives of Muhammad, what legacy has this left for other Muslim women throughout the world because of the example of Muhammad's wives in particular?
It's a really important question, especially when you compare it to the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament, maybe more of that later. But when you look at Muhammad and the legacy with his wives, of course, they're the mothers of believers, so they need to be looked to, they need to be referred to. You will see, just like as Rocky said, you will see where women are paying in many ways for the sins of men. So take in Surah 33:53. It's a very interesting, very, very interesting verse in the whole of the Quran. It reveals a whole lot of things about Allah, about Muhammad, about his wives, about men and women and gender segregation and separation and so on. And that's that little verse in there, verse 53 of chapter 33 of the Quran. You will have people who companions of Muhammad that want to go visit him and they want to have a meal. And Allah tells them that they must just be quick. They mustn't sit around for a conversation because it could annoy the Prophet easily. And it says that Allah is telling them these things because Muhammad is shy to say these things. And then it has a story in there, or verse, a bit in the verse there, when you have they're not allowed to talk, so the male companions are not allowed to talk to Muhammad's wives face to face. It must be from behind a veil or a curtain, in essence, a hijab. This is the concept of gender segregation. And so even just the free mixing of men and women in there was stopped just because of what it seemed that Muhammad was being pleased by Allah, that Allah wanted to help Muhammad in his wishes. And then at the very end of the verse, it says that Muhammad's wives could not then be married once Muhammad died. And those rules and regulations began to become normative for the women of Islam, both when Muhammad was living and especially after he died. You have stories of how Muhammad got his women. A really good example of how Muhammad got his women we have happening in our world today. Let's look at ISIS, and a lot of people cringe when people raise ISIS. A lot of Muslims say, oh, you know, let's not listen anymore because she's raising ISIS. But actually, ISIS and what ISIS has done, and groups similar to it, Al-Shabaab and Boko Haram in northern Nigeria, which has really shown a clear example of what Muhammad did with women. And you find when you look at what Muhammad did, he would go through his part of the world, and he was pillaging the villages, and he would take the women for himself and his companions. And he would take the most beautiful ones often for himself. Most of his wives were under 20 years old. Most of them were teenagers. A few were very young. And so you have this scenario for the women in Islam. And for the last 1400 years of Islam, that kind of scenario has happened. One of my colleagues, Sarah, has done an interesting study. You can find a video of her, Sarah Foster, online. She has been on here on the show before. And she did a study on the sub-Saharan slave trade, looking at how Islam moved across Africa, the east of Africa and the north of Africa. And it was the precursor to the transatlantic slave trade that went on for 400 years, which is heinous in and of itself. But the sub-Saharan slave trade, which still, by the way, in places exists today, which was started by Islam, is really referred to in the Quran, Surah 4, chapter 3, Surah 4, 4, verse 3 and Surah 4, verse 24, which implies how a man can take a slave girl for himself if he isn't able to have four women and he isn't able to treat them equally. He can take what his right hand possesses. And all the exegetes of the early exegetes of Islam say that those are the women that you own, and you can have them for sexual pleasure as well as marry them. And that is the legacy of Islam. We see it in Boko Haram today. We see it in Al-Shabaab. We see it with ISIS. We see it with Al-Qaeda. And we see this because this is what Islam teaches according to its text. The Quran teaches this. Muhammad's life exemplified it. And we see it in the movements, Islamic movements today, that go back to those texts, that take their Quran seriously. That's the legacy of Muhammad. Do a comparison with the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at how he compared women. It's phenomenal to do a comparison between the two, because Jesus would never have treated a woman like that. He never did. And he treated them equally. He treated them as friends, and he treated them non-sexually. It almost seems with Muhammad that a woman's, when a man looks at a woman with, from Muhammad's legacy and from Islam's legacy, it always seems to be in a sexual context, unless, of course, it's your own daughter. But other than that, a woman from outside your own family is seen in a sexual light. And I find that quite troubling.
And I really need to get this video, and you, all viewers, need to get this video and share this, especially with people in America. They have all these women over here who are completely ignorant of Islamic history, and they're putting on hijabs for solidarity and supporting women, who wear it. Obviously, Muslim women in America who wear it, obviously they wear it because, you know, lots of times they have a husband who makes them wear it or a father who makes them wear it. Sometimes they choose to, but this is way different than in the East. This is way different than Islamic history itself. And I wish all the American women over here would look to Islamic history and take that into account when they want to decide to put the hijab on for solidarity, or thinking that it ennobles women or anything like that. Because if you look to history, it is the exact opposite. But in spite of that, the Dean Squad has a brand new video called Cover Girl. And throughout this video, like I said, it's just women in hijabs. And it says, this is some of the lyrics. Dear Islamophobes, let me put you on blast. You want to kick the Muslims out, but you know we got class. This is for my sisters in the West. 2017, she ain't trying to be oppressed. She represents peace, and she got her own voice, and she's not forced to wear it because she made her own choice. Aw, yeah. That's what they say. That's part of that song. So we see here in the West, yes, they are choosing it, and they are making a very foolish decision to do that because they obviously do not know Islamic history. They do not know that this is actually a sign of oppression, because it is Islamic history, Muhammad himself and his early followers, who forced people to do this. Now, even though here in the West, obviously, there is more freedom of speech and freedom of religion and stuff like that than there are in Middle Eastern countries, but to actually make a choice to wear it, I want to wear this, is a very foolish one when you look to Islamic history. Now, we need to take a short break, but all of this information that these great ladies have given you, we are still only a third into the program, so we have a lot more to come. Please stay right where you are, because we'll be back in just a couple of minutes.
Now that we have launched the first stage of the ABN Digital Tree, you can watch and view the new channels on all of our platforms, outlets, apps, and websites. The total cost of the release and launch of the first two stages of the digital tree totals up to be $65,000. However, we are at a shortage of funds and only have about $15,000 to support the first two stages of the digital tree. We ask for your prayers and your financial support to maintain the first stage of the tree, as well as supporting the launch of stage two that will release on April 12th. With our Lord, we will water the seed together as a ministry in order to bring more souls to Jesus. If you would like to donate, please call the numbers at your screen or visit our website at trinitychannel.com.
Hello, friends. Welcome back to ABN's Trinity Channel for the first International Apologetics Marathon of 2017. It is so great to have you here if you are a live viewer, or if you're watching this after the fact when it's on YouTube. Please get the link and share that with your friends, family, and everyone else, not only through email, but also on Facebook, Twitter, and other platforms as well. It is great to be back here on day number 5 of the first week of the 2-week International Apologetics Marathon. I'm your host, Tony Grulet, and it's a blessing to be here to serve you. And actually, this show is a little bit unique because I get to rap a little bit. I get to work on my hip-hop skills, but that's only because of the topic that we are talking about, and that is Khadijah, Muhammad's pre-Islamic wife. And I have two ladies here with me. I have Beth Grove from the Fander Center in the UK, and I have Rocky Nasser, who is here in the United States, and she has a master's degree in theology and is a former Muslim and has a lot of knowledge about this as well. And this is really making me want to have a Beth and Rocky marathon maybe somewhere down the roads. So we'll have to schedule that. But we are talking about Khadijah, Muhammad's pre-Islamic wife, and what was her life like, and the problem that so many people today, especially here in the West, point to her and overlook every other wife and woman under Islam since then. So, speaking of that, this is a very important show for all people, especially people in the UK and in the West, in countries that haven't studied Islamic history, are not being Islamized as much as other countries already have been. And of course, countries that are not under Sharia, they need to look to Islamic history. And a lot of people are not doing that. That's why they listen to their Muslim coworker, their neighbor who they love. Their Muslim neighbor or coworker loves America, loves American freedom, loves the Constitution, loves the Bill of Rights. That is great. But your Muslim neighbor who you love does not define Islam. Muhammad defined Islam 1,400 years ago. So, Rocky, what are some negative things in Islam that deal with women?
Well, if you don't mind, Tony, one thing I wanted to mention that I didn't mention about the positive things, I'd like to just address that issue because, you know, we don't want to leave any rock unturned here.
Yeah.
I know that in the Quran, and there's some hadith about mothers and how do you deal with mothers? And so one man went to Muhammad and he said to him, you know, Muhammad, who should be a good friend to me? Who should I, you know, rely on as a friend? And basically Muhammad said to him, your mother. And then he says, then who else? And he says, your mother. So he repeats this 3 times. And then after that, he says, who else? And then he says, your father. And then I've heard this verse from Muslims, or this hadith from Muslims, where they say that heaven is under the feet of mothers. And so one of my friends, I asked him that question. I said to him, so let me ask you a question. If I just was good to my mom and was not good to my dad, for example, let's say I was just kind to my mom and not kind to my dad, would that allow me to enter heaven? And he said, no, it wouldn't. I said, let's suppose I was kind to my mom and I did not, you know, pray 5 times a day. Does that mean that I can enter into heaven? Because it says that heaven is under the feet of mothers, right? And he said, no, you can't. And I said, it's one thing to say something about mothers. It's a completely different thing when you look at it and try to apply it. And so I know that, you know, Muslims use that very often. And they say, look at how, you know, Muhammad honored mothers. And there's a difference between the way, as Beth mentioned earlier, of the way a mother is respected or a daughter is respected versus a wife or just a woman outside of your family. She is looked at differently. For example, Muhammad allowed men to have sex with married women who were slave women. So let's say, and an example of that is Safiya, one of his wives. So she was from the tribe of Quraizah. Mm-hmm. And she, Muhammad went in to raid that tribe, and he tortured her husband, Kinana. And after he tortured her husband, Kinana, they beheaded him. And they took her as one of the spoils. And so Muhammad found out how beautiful she was. And so he met with her. He killed her father. He killed her brother. He killed her husband. And that same night, he had sex with her. Because in Islam, according to Surah 424, that was allowed for him. Muhammad also said about a Persian queen. There was the queen of the daughter of Khuruzo. And I don't know how to pronounce his name, but she became the queen of Persia. And basically Muhammad said, never will succeed such a nation as makes a woman their ruler. That's a problem. You know, a man can marry up to 4 wives. That issue of the temporary marriage That's a problem. That it seems like Islam was designed for men's sexual pleasures and sexual desires, because for some reason, Islam portrays men as men who are not men are not able to control themselves sexually. No offense, Tony, but that's the way men are portrayed in Islam. And as a result, women are to be are to respond or to react based on that.
You are not offending me. Actually, I am way ahead of you, because on Monday evening, we actually did a show called Sex and Marriage, Islam versus Christianity. And we talked about how basically Muhammad gave these promises. I mean, hey, you follow me in this life, you get women, you get booty, you know, basically, well, women, but also the spoils of war. And hey, if you happen to die fighting for me, what are you going to get in the next life? More women, and you know, and just promise them all these things. So it's like, definitely, he was appealing to the testosterone and desires of man and all of his promises. And how can we expect men to say, "Oh, I don't want any of that," you know, when they're living in the 7th century and all that? So that is a show that people need to watch as well. Combine this show with Sex and Marriage, Islam versus Christianity, as well as a show that we did on Tuesday called Is the Muslim Brotherhood a Threat to America? Because people need to see that, as well as the video that I did. I actually have a video on my Vimeo channel, vimeo.com/Tony Gourlay. It's called The Muslim Brotherhood, Origin, Identity, and Agenda. I cover from the time of Muhammad all the way up till now. And you say, you're talking about ISIS. You're talking about, Beth talked about ISIS. People say, oh, in the West, oh, yeah, they're not Islamic. They're very Islamic when you look at the life of Muhammad and compare his actions to them. Because ISIS and their daily actions line up closer to the life of Muhammad than, again, your Muslim neighbor here in America who loves American freedom and loves the Bill of Rights and loves the Constitution and doesn't want the world to be under Sharia. They just want freedom themselves. That is completely different. ISIS is much closer to Muhammad than many Muslims here in the West, and of course, even many Muslims throughout the world. There, you know, there's 1.6 billion. A lot of them just want to live their lives. They want to raise their children. They are not really striving to follow Muhammad, which technically they need to do in order to be a good Muslim according to Muhammad, but they just aren't doing what he said, but technically that's a good thing. So, Beth, are the lives of Muhammad's wives the kind of life that you would like to lead? If yes, then why? If no, then why as well?
Absolutely not. I mean, Khadijah is its closest just because she represents a pre-Islamic woman. But when Islam became a religion and Muhammad really established himself according to Islamic tradition, not necessarily according to what history is telling us, but according to Islamic tradition, when Muhammad established himself as a prophet and then he started taking these many wives after Khadijah died, when I look at the lot that those women had, it's just not something I'd want to follow at all. Rocky picked up on that when he talked about Safiya. A couple of his wives were taken as loot in war when they'd gone in and they killed the husbands and then took it for him, took the women for himself. And also among his men, there's a very disturbing hadith in a Bukhari volume 5, book 59. And it talks about how the men had gone in and celibacy was getting difficult upon themselves. And they started to sleep with the women that they had conquered, and they had potentially killed the families of these women and taken them in. And they were sleeping with these women, and they were concerned that these girls and these women would get pregnant. And they went to Muhammad and they asked Muhammad what to do about this, because the women might get pregnant if they continue to sleep with these women. And Muhammad, instead of protecting those slave girls who'd just been conquered and taken as loot in war, instead of protecting them, he said, well, if Allah so wishes for a child to exist, then so be it. It was the idea that continue to sleep with the women. If they get pregnant, so be it. And this is who Muhammad was according to Islamic tradition. Mm-hmm. When I look at that and I think, first of all, is that a role model for today? Absolutely not. It's not even a role model for his time. In his time, that was abuse against women, let alone what it would be in our time. It would be against the laws of the Western land. It is not against the laws of Islam itself. Take the Islamic law, take Sharia law.
It was interesting. I was reading through some of the law books that were printed in America. These are the Islamic law books of the Islamic law. And there's four schools of law in Sunni Islam. And then you have the you have the one that is more Shia Islam. And I was looking at the four schools of law in Sunni Islam. And this was one manual that was printed in America. And it was fascinating. When it came to the bit on women who are to be enslaved, it says, well, this is no longer relevant for today. And so it didn't translate from the Arabic into the English what was in the laws. And I thought, that's fascinating. This was, I think, translated by Muslims who lived in America. They didn't want Americans to read what their law books actually teach. And yet, if Islam came to power, those law books would be the basis of society, because they don't separate state and they don't separate religion. It's together, which means that if Islam came to power, then those laws, which are only in the Arabic, would then be put into place in America. So this idea that Islam ennobles women, or that the wives are as people we can look to, that Muhammad was an example, none of this, according to their own text, is something that I would want to follow. Take, for example, the story that Rocky said earlier, where she was talking about the peeping Toms. I don't know if that's an English phrase. We say that when a man is peeping on a woman, whether she be in a state of undress, or the story that she was telling of the women going out to use the toilet outside, and he was looking at them, and the people complained, and that's why they had to start wearing the hijab. Instead of Muhammad challenging the man who is the peeping Tom, who is checking out these women, he makes the women cover. Instead of challenging the man that was looking at them, he makes the women cover. And then that's become the lot of women all through society. So it seems that women are always the ones that take the burden of the weakness of man. And another thing that is troubling is, what does that say about men? How does God view men in Islam? How does Islam itself, how did Muhammad and so on, how does that view men? It's as if they can't control themselves. Not only do I find that just insulting to me as a woman, that is insulting to men. It's the fact that men can't control themselves, and so women suffer as a result. So there's all sorts of things happening through history at the time of Muhammad, and what we see in happening today, that has affected women and is detrimental for women. So no, Muhammad and his wives are not the example that we are to follow today.
And I said, people need to watch the Sex and Marriage, Islam versus Christianity, to really get into the details of what Muhammad promised to men in this life and in the next, especially in the next, because not only do we cover what Muhammad said himself, but we actually were quoting different tafsirs throughout the ages, even al-Sayuti, who's one of the Jalal's tafsir al-Jalalain, and he died in 1505. So anyone who thinks that the Islamic view of sex and sexual promises has been reformed sometime between the time of Muhammad and now, at least up until 1505, it was actually more detailed than what Muhammad gave himself. And even today, there are still Muslims who are dying in jihad, and they're doing that not because they know that Islam's a lie and I'm just going to do it anyway. They actually believe that it is true. They actually believe that they're going to get this reward, and how sad it is for them when they die and find out that is not the case, and that Jesus is not just a prophet. He is the Lord Jesus Christ, who all people will stand before and be judged. And that's why we want to get the gospel out to Muslims throughout the world, in the East, in the West. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Muslims believe in God. They believe in Jesus, but they need to know who God is and who Jesus is, and of course, what God requires of them, which is much different than what Muslims believe. When they follow the five pillars, when they strive to follow the sunnah, the example that Muhammad gave, and all of that. And I want to ask Rocky, because you have a heart for evangelism, much like myself and much like Beth as well, and we wants to get the gospel to Muslim women. And you ladies, you too, as well as all of the other women viewers who we have throughout the world right now, you have an opportunity that many Christian men do not have, and that is that you can talk to conservative Muslim women who purposely try to not talk to men who they're not married to. They don't try to talk to Western men. So we really want to encourage women out there, especially Christian women, to reach out to the Muslim women around you. Unfortunately, a lot of people demonize all Muslims. They demonize, you know, even Muslims here in the West. Oh, you know, they're evil. Stay away from them. You know, they demonize them. They demonize everything. And who wants to hug a demon, right? It's like, you know, you don't listen to some people who are out there. Reach out to Muslim women. And I want to ask you, Rocky, how should women and men too, if they are able to, view Muslim women and perhaps reach out to them?
Well, if you don't mind, can I just take a step back here for a second?
Go ahead.
I know you talked about Beth. Would Beth want to, you know, be under the Sharia law and be, you know, a Muslim woman? Yeah. One of the things that Muslim women also talk about, or men talk about, is they say that women are honored in Islam because there's an entire surah that's called women. And this is very interesting because, you know, again, Hamid at Hamid.tv on YouTube or Box of Islam on Facebook, he says, then that means that the ant was honored because there's a surah named the ant. There is, you know, the spider is honored because then there's a surah called the spider. So, you know, I don't know, but I, you know, if I was Beth, Tony, I would be offended that you asked me that question. Yeah. I'm just kidding here because, you know, that's not really honoring women. A lot of what's in Islam, they say that women are being honored, but it's truly, you know, they're not being honored. Now, one thing that I heard Beth say before is she's always said, you know, I separate the ideology from the people. And that's true. You know, Muslims are one thing and Islam is a completely different thing. And so when we look at these women come and they are desperate. They need the very things that every woman needs. They need to be loved. They need to be valued. They need to be treasured. They need to be honored. It's not any different. All women who have children want their kids to grow, to be successful in life, to be healthy, to take care of their children. And so if we look past the head covering, one time I was at a women's conference and I asked my Christian sisters, I said to them, when you look at a woman with a head covering, what do you think of automatically? And one person was very honest with me. She said, well, I think that she's got a bomb under her clothing. Mm. I mean, that's the attitude of Christians. And that's not true. Not all women, first of all, not all women really know, or not all Muslims really know exactly what is written in Islam. And they are not commanded to think critically about Islam itself. They are to take what is written about it and accept it completely. Because if they do question it, it's considered a sin. And so that's a problem for these women. These women are under a darkness, a spiritual darkness. And they are not encouraged to ask questions. They are not encouraged to wonder why. They are not encouraged to say, wait a minute, Muhammad said that women lack intelligence and they lack knowledge. So what does that mean to lack intelligence and lack knowledge? What does that mean that Muhammad, that Zainab, you know, that God allowed Muhammad to marry Zainab? They're not permitted, according to Islam, to even ask those questions. And so we just need to learn to separate the religion from the people, because the majority of the people either don't understand Islam fully, it has been sugar-coated to them, they are not encouraged to question Islam, and so they are under a lot of pressure. And what we need to do as believers in Jesus Christ, as women, is we need to see them as we see ourselves. We are women who are desperately in need of to be encouraged, to be loved, to be cherished, to be valued. And most importantly, we are women who need to be freed by the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. And speaking of Jesus Christ and women, I want to ask Beth, how does this compare? What we've talked about in this show so far, how does this compare with how Jesus treated women?
Yeah, it's an amazing comparison. Going back to what Rocky said, we have a little tagline in Fando. We use it on all our social media platforms, and we say, critique Islam, love Muslims. That just says it in a nutshell. Critique Islam, which is what we're doing right now, but love Muslims. And we critique Islam because we love Muslims. Mm-hmm. Because we love Muslims, we want to critique it. We want to help them understand their ideology and help people, the world, understand what is behind the abuse of women in the Muslim world, what's behind the atrocities we see happening around the world because of the ideology of Islam. Critique Islam, love Muslims. And going back to the whole value of woman in Islam, look at Jesus Christ. We have another little saying that we say in Islam. And if you go and look online, you'll see a quick little talk that I did with my colleague Sarah, and we did a comparison between Jesus and Muhammad. It wasn't necessarily relating to woman, but it was a comparison. You can find that on YouTube at Six Point Foundation. And you will find when you do a comparison to how Jesus treated woman compared to how Muhammad treated woman, and in Founder we say the man in the book, the man in the book, and that's a quote that Jay Smith came up with, and it works on in every time that you are discussing anything to do with religion, be it Christianity or be it with Islam, the rule or the foundation that you go with is look at the man, look at the book. For Islam, you look at Muhammad, you look at the Quran. For Christians, you look at the law. You look at the Bible, especially the New Testament. And of course, when we say the book and the man in Christianity, we look at Jesus as God who came to us. There's something, he's more than just a mere man. Look at Jesus versus Muhammad. I mean, I love to compare, for example, the story of the Samaritan woman in the book of John, chapter 4. The Samaritan woman was a woman from another tribe. She wasn't fully Jewish. She was a Samaritan. She was an immoral woman. She was not a woman who was considered righteous. And God himself had sat down at the well. God was speaking to her, because that's who Jesus is, and he was talking to her, and he knew that she was an immoral woman, and she knew that she was a woman that the Jews technically were supposed to despise. And look how he treated her. He talked with her as someone who was valuable, and she actually became one of the first evangelists. She became one of the first people to bring her village to Christ, and they all believed in him and believed the message. So you have that story. Then I love the story of Mary and Martha. They were some of Jesus' best friends, and they were sitting with Jesus. Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, talking with him, as in that culture, men would talk with each other. She was being treated as an equal. In fact, the Bible says very clearly that women are equal in the grace of life. We find that in the book of Peter. There's a story after story. You have the women who traveled with the disciples of Jesus, and it says that they looked after the companions or the disciples of Jesus and Jesus himself, and used their means to support them. They were traveling with them. These were not part of any biological family of the companions of Jesus. These were women who had nothing to do with the family, but they were seen as healthy. We use the word platonic, i.e. non-sexual relationships with these women, but they were not part of any biological family. They were just women who were also disciples of Jesus. I love the way Jesus treated them. And this is what's more. Jesus treated single women equal. Jesus treated women who weren't mothers, who weren't women who were women that would be normally respected in religious circles. Look at Muhammad, and look at that quote that we talked about earlier, which says, paradise lies at the feet of mothers. Just recently, I was talking with a Muslim missionary, and he said, look how we revere women. We say that paradise lies at the feet of mothers. I said, oh, really? Well, then that leaves me out. I'm not a mother. I'm not a wife. That leaves me out completely of the picture. Does paradise lie at my feet as a non-married, as a childless woman? Does paradise lie at my feet? And I said, you know, in Jesus Christ, paradise lies at my feet, because I enter paradise. I will go to heaven. I will be with God. I will live with God. God will dwell with me and all of those believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we find that story and or that idea in Revelation 21, where all of us will dwell with him, male and female. We will dwell with God himself. And that's the whole point of Christianity. And it doesn't matter whether you're married, it doesn't matter whether you're single, it doesn't matter what status you have in life, it doesn't matter whether you're children or not. Woman is valuable and equal to man in the grace of life. And the whole of the way Jesus interacted with both male and female, rich and poor, Jesus showed, Jew and Gentile, Jesus showed that they were valuable, and that the whole message of God's salvation, gift to human beings, is for all human beings. That's the difference between Muhammad and Jesus? Muhammad did none of that. Muhammad had adulterous wit. Muhammad rejected some women. Muhammad suppressed his wives. Muhammad got specific revelations from heaven, or convenient revelations from heaven, to allow him to marry these women, including his adopted son's wife, Zainab. There's disturbing story after disturbing story of how Muhammad treated women. And compare that to Jesus. He never treated women badly. He never looked down on them. He always included them as equal and as valuable in his conversations.
Amen. And that's why we encourage our viewers to look to the Quran and the Hadith. The Quran is supposedly the eternal word of Allah incarnate, or if you hold a Quran in your hand, it's pretty much a finite copy of what is believed to be an eternal book. But look at that, and then look at the Hadith. The Hadith are the sayings of Muhammad, what Muhammad approved of, what he said to do. So the Hadith is what Muhammad said to do, and that's not above the Quran, but it's very close, because any Sunni Muslim, which is 90% roughly of all the Muslims in the world, they follow the Sunnah, the example of Muhammad. So where is that found? That's found in the Hadith. They combine that with the Quran. Combining those, that is how Sharia is derived. Islamic law is derived from those major sources. But also you want to look to the Sirah literature, the earliest biographies of Muhammad. And look at those. And what do those say about Muhammad? And then compare that to the New Testament. And Beth brought up the woman at the well. Did she go back to her village saying, man, Jesus really hates women and Christianity is really oppressive? No, she came back and said, hey, look at the man, you know, listen to this, or come see this man who told me everything I've ever done. You know, she knew that he was more than a prophet. Look at Jesus and the woman caught in adultery. Did he say, oh, she committed adultery, oh, stone her right now? He said, no. He said, he who is without sin cast the first stone. And we read that everyone walked away. And there's different speculations on why they walked away. But we know, the Bible tells us, that the law is written upon our hearts. We have the Ten Commandments. Look at the law of Musa in Exodus chapter 20, Deuteronomy chapter 5. We have all broken those. It doesn't matter if you call yourself a Christian, a Muslim, a Mormon, a Jehovah's Witness, an atheist, an agnostic, or anything else. We have broken God's law, and that is why we need a Savior. And the salvation is found only in the Lord Jesus Christ. But this is much different than what we hear from Muhammad and what Islam teaches about women. Basically, the majority of people in hell will be women. Why? Because they're deficient in their religion, they're deficient in their intellect, and so on. So much different view of women. And we have people all the time who, you know, again, we have these Muslims in the West who are living moderate lives right now, and it's either because they don't know Islamic history themselves, they haven't read the sources, they're more focused on just following the five pillars and not questioning, like has been brought up. They don't question the Quran, they don't question it. It's just more about obedience, where Christianity is a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, His Son. So much different dynamic, and we encourage you to look to the Quran, the Hadith, the Sirah literature, and then compare that to the New Testament. We say, hey, if you want to know about Christianity, look to the words of Jesus. If you want to know about Islam, look to the words of Muhammad and the Quran. That is the comparison that needs to be made. Here in the West, people say, oh, you need to act more like Jesus. And then when we do, they complain about that too, right? But when it comes to Islam, people ask all the time, what would, you know, they see the bracelets, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Well, you need to ask, what would Muhammad do? And the only way you're going to know that is if you look to the earliest sources. And compare that with, again, your Muslim neighbors who you love, who you do want to reach out to and share the gospel with. And if they're not following Muhammad, that is a good thing, technically. But they are not actually following what their religion teaches. I cannot say it enough. Muhammad defined Islam, not your modern-day Muslim who is living in America peacefully and just loves American freedom and doesn't want to even live in the Middle East themselves. So we need to take a short break. This will be our last break before we come back with even more information for you. And as you can hear, and as you've seen, this is a great show. So take the URL once it's available on YouTube and share it with everyone who you can, because everyone needs this information. Thank you, and stay right where you are, because we will be back very soon.
ABN and Trinity Channel is excited to announce the good news about the new channels. You can now watch the ABN Digital Tree on both of our sites and experience great quality videos through your laptop or your computer. You can visit abnsat.com and click on the button called ABN TV Channels and enjoy watching over 20 channels in different languages, with 6 channels in English about apologetics. You can also watch our digital tree from www.trinitychannel.com and click on the button called Watch Us Live. For more information, please call the numbers at your screen, as we are in need of your prayers, your help, and your support.
Hello friends, welcome back to ABN and the Trinity Channel for the first International Apologetics Marathon of 2017. Today is day 5. We're finishing up the first week of the 2-week International Apologetics Marathon, but not with this show. We still have 2 more shows later on today. We have Islam and the News, as usual, bringing you news headlines about Christianity, Islam, Sharia, persecution, jihad, and so on, that you will not find on the mainstream media. So please stay tuned for that at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And then this evening at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time is Christian Persecution and Islamic Extremism. So please stay tuned for that as well. But check out these shows that we've already done this week, especially on the topic of Islam, which is probably something that you're interested in if you're watching this right now. Back on Monday, we did Sex and Marriage, Islam versus Christianity. Tuesday, we did Do Muslims Break the First Commandment? And then we did Is the Muslim Brotherhood a Threat to America? On Wednesday, just a couple of days ago, we did Dawah versus Evangelism. If you don't know what Dawah is, please check out that show and learn about the nature of both, of similarities as well as the differences. And of course, I had great guests on all of these shows, so please check those out. And today is the first show of 3 during the first week of the International Apologetics Marathon, on this last day of the marathon, of the first week of the marathon at least. We still have all next week too, including a debate next Friday, March 31st, between Usama Dokdok and Yusuf Ismail from South Africa, a Christian versus a Muslim, and what question are they going to be debating? Is ISIS a true representation of Islam? So, please watch that next week and share that with people as well. And of course, more great shows Monday through Thursday next week as well. But we still have a little bit of time left in this show, Khadijah, Muhammad's pre-Islamic wife. And I have had 2 very informative, great guests on this show. And that is Beth Grove from the UK, from the Fander Center. And if you want to head down to Speaker's Corner, you can hear her as well as other people from Fander make a case for Christianity and defend the historic Christian faith and, of course, share the gospel with people who need to know and understand it. And, of course, Rocky Nasser, who's here in the United States, former Muslim, who now, by God's grace, is a Christian because she repented and put her trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, the true Jesus of Nazareth of the New Testament, not the Isa of the Quran. There's a big difference there as well. And I want to get back to this vital topic which people need to know about, and we've given a whole lot of information, so please watch this show and share it with other people. But Rocky, what do Muslim women need today? For if people here in the United States want to reach out to Muslim women, what is something for them to keep in mind when they want to reach out to those women?
Well, I think my challenge is twofold. My challenge is for Muslim women, and my challenge is for my Christian sisters. And my challenge to the Muslim women is, I just want to ask them, are you okay with the Quran calling you a field and that your husband can come to you as he comes to a field? Are you okay with that? Are you okay with Muhammad and Allah permitting women to be enslaved and to be sex slaves for these men? Are you okay with that? Are you okay with the way Muhammad treated the issue of Zainab and the issue of Aisha? Are you okay with that? Are you okay? You need to study Islam. You need to think about it. You need to consider whether these are things that you want to live with for the rest of your life. The other challenge that I have for them is you have to ask yourself the question. Look at the verses that deal with women, that deal with Muhammad, and ask yourself the question, are these truly from God? Is this truly what God would have? Would God have a man called a prophet to marry a 6-year-old and consummate his marriage with her at 9 years old? I had a friend who was from Pakistan. She was a Muslim, and she was asking these questions. And she had a daughter, a six-year-old daughter, and she was playing on the floor. And then she was studying about Aisha, and she looked at her six-year-old daughter, and she said, "This is the age of Aisha when Muhammad married her, and he was in his 50s. And at that point, that's when she decided, I'm not going to do it. So I want to challenge my Muslim friends, my Muslim sisters out there, to think about what Islam said about women and how he treated these women. And are you okay with that? Are you okay with that? Do you want to live with that? My challenge to my Christian sisters is you have to see Muslim women as Christ sees them. He loves them. He died on the cross for them. His desire is that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The Old Testament says that God does not delight in the death of the wicked, even if they are your enemies, even if there's a bomb under their dresses. God still loves them, and he desires for them to know him. And so I think we need to break the barriers. There's a lot of misconceptions about Christian women, and there's a lot of misconceptions about Muslim women. And we have to consider these misconceptions. Muslim women will look at women in the West and they think they're Madonnas, you know, they're exploited, they can wear whatever they want to wear, they go out and have sex and so on and so forth. And that is further from the truth as far as what Christ says and what the Bible says. So helping them differentiate between the Western culture and what the Bible says and the biblical truth about that and the purity that we are called to. I think we need to help them understand their value in what the Bible said and how Christ honored women and how he loves them and has a plan for them. I've had the privilege of seeing many women who are Arab that have studied and asked themselves the questions and have come to the conclusion that Christ died on the cross for them, that Christ loves them. And so we can't not ask the question. We need to ask the question. We need to research. We need to study. There's so many different resources out there. Study the original text. There's wikiislam.net that you can go to and read about those different issues. There's videos that are in Arabic, as I mentioned. You know, Hamid Abdel Samad, he was a man from Egypt who questioned his faith, began to question why things were written in there. He was a part of the Muslim Brotherhood, and all of a sudden he walked away from Islam because of the things that he saw in Islam. And so he's done these videos in Arabic, Hamid.net on Facebook, on YouTube, or Box of Islam on Facebook. Watch those videos. Ask yourself those questions. And my challenge to my Christian sisters is Christ has called us to make disciples of all nations. God is bringing the nations here to us, to Europe, to the United States, and he's doing it because he desires that every tribe, every tongue, every nation will bow their knee to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and that will include Arab women, and that will include Muslim women.
And friends, we cannot expect any non-Christian to share the gospel with the Muslims who are here in America. Right. Christians need to reach out to your Muslim neighbors. If you don't do it, who's going to do it? There are many people out there who critique Islam, but they're not Christians. So the gospel is never going to come in their message. We as Christians need to share the gospel. And like Raghi said, I mean, you have these refugees who are coming here. You have immigrants who have been here for a while. And a lot of them don't have any American friends. They're so intimidating to the average American that no one reaches out to them. And many Muslims, of course, have come to Christ through, obviously, dreams and visions that God is still doing today. But also, they have, of course, questioned the Quran, even though they're not supposed to, technically. And many Muslims, of course, through polemics, which is something that that Beth does a lot from Fander Center, you know, they start to learn the actual history about Islam, and they start to question it. But at the same time, many Muslims have come to Christ because of the love that they see from Christians. And we as Christians need to love our Muslim neighbors. Like they said, you know, we need to critique Islam, but we need to love Muslims because Muslims are people who are made in the image of God. And Muslims don't go to hell because they're Muslims. They go to hell because they are people who have sinned against a holy God and they never repent and put their trust in Christ. So, you know, people don't go to hell just because they're Muslims or because they're Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses. No matter what you call yourself, you've sinned against a holy God, and that is why you need a Savior. And we as Christians need to let Muslims know about that Savior, who they can then believe in, trust in, and repent and receive eternal life, which is something that we receive here in this life. It's not just trying to get to paradise or hoping that your good makes up for your bad. Jesus Christ did the work for us. We just need to repent and put our trust in him. Now, speaking of Jesus Christ, Beth, did Muhammad, who was born about 540 years after Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, and at the same time, Islam proclaims that Jesus talked about Muhammad, he prophesied Muhammad, even though we see that that is not the case when we look at the context and the actual definitions of the words in the Bible. But did Muhammad follow Jesus' example of how men and women should behave together?
Absolutely not. If you look at how Jesus treated women, he went against his culture. He actually, in his practice and what he said, went against his culture when he interacted with women. And he really showed an example of how women are valuable. Muhammad, not only did he cave into his culture, not only did he do what his culture really expected of him, he didn't rise above his culture. And some Muslims say, when you look at Muhammad's example, some of the more feminist, modernist Muslims will say that, well, we know compared to today, and even compared to Jesus, Muhammad didn't necessarily elevate the position of women, but he set in motion a movement towards the ennoblement of women. And that's the sort of the apologetic I've heard coming from some Muslim friends. But actually, when you look at what Muhammad did, he didn't set in motion any movement towards an ennoblement of women at all. He really put rules and some sort of suppression on women. And again, some Muslims will come back and say, well, no, these rules actually were in contrast to the totally unruly lifestyle of the Arabs that he was moving among. We don't really know that. We just look at Khadijah from the Islamic sources to do a comparison. If the women are considered unruly and Khadijah represents them, then really their apologetic doesn't stand up. And you look at, for example, the whole idea that women, not only in Muhammad's time, but even today, are suffering because of the sins of men. A good friend of mine and a colleague, Lizzie Schofield, you can look at her video on our Founder Film site. She's just done a really good discussion with some Muslim missionaries at Speaker's Corner. About the whole concept of women are having to cover up and wear the hijab because of the sin of man. Whilst in the Bible, the Bible tells women to be modest, but it's got nothing to do with the sin of men and so on. And so women suffer and are paying the consequence because of what the Quran perceives as the weakness and sin of men. And of course, the life of Muhammad exemplifies that. So you just you look at the whole comparison between Islam and Christianity, between Muhammad and Jesus. Muhammad went against what Jesus taught. I studied the Quran under a Hafiz. A Hafiz is someone who knows the Quran off by heart. He used to be an Islamic law teacher, and he actually knows the Quran in three different languages. Now he turned to Christ, and he has left Islam behind. He's walked out of Islam, and he's turned to the Lord Jesus Christ, and now he's a Christian. And as he was teaching us the Quran, he was saying how Muhammad came to undermine and undo the work of Christ. Muhammad came to undermine and undo the work of Christ. Another quote that is from a man I know from North Africa, and he said this, that on every point of the gospel, so on every point of the good news of God coming to walk and talk with us so that we could go back into relationship with him as friends and enter into heaven with him and one day live with him and dwell with him, and he dwell with us, he says that on every point of the good news of the gospel, Islam teaches the opposite. And that goes right down to how men are to view women, how men treat women, how Muhammad treated women, how Muhammad's companions treated women, and how for 400 years there's been abuse of women because of the theology and ideology and the practice of Islam and Muhammad. Compare that to the Lord Jesus Christ. Muhammad not only disobeyed his own Quran, i.e., Chapter 4, verse 3 says to marry just 4 women. Muhammad married at least 12. He disobeyed his own Quran. And Surah 33 tells us very clearly that Allah allows him to take off and postpone what woman he wanted. And then, of course, it stopped that. But there's this idea in the text that he could postpone, take on what he wanted. You compare that to Jesus. Jesus became the law for us. Jesus is the one who set the example for us. Jesus showed how to treat women, even women of the night. He didn't sleep with those women. He didn't stone them to death. He took them, he forgave them, and he reinstated them as valuable, saved, precious women to God. Now, that's the example of Jesus Christ. Muhammad disobeyed his own Quran, and he disobeyed the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing about the life of Muhammad resembles Jesus Christ at all. So when Muslims are abused, and I know Muslim women who have been abused, the message for them is to go back to Jesus, because Jesus would never abuse them.
Thank you so much for that, Beth. And we do encourage our viewers out there to read the New Testament, read the words of Jesus himself, and compare that to the Quran, the Hadith, and the Sirah literature. Now, I have something I want to share, and then I'm going to be asking both Rocky and Beth for their closing statements. But in this show, Rocky a number of times has mentioned Hamed Abdel-Samad. Now, I just happen to have his book right here, his English translation, Islamic Fascism. And this is the controversial German work, now updated and expanded and in English for the first time. So you can go on Amazon or anywhere where fine books are sold and pick up this book, because he goes in depth on a lot of information. So pick that up. But if you read this book, and if you read the Quran, you read the Hadith, you read the Sirah literature, and you then start sharing that information with people, especially here in the West, you may be called a few different names. Perhaps the first one is going to be bigot. But if you look up the definition of bigot, a bigot is a person who strongly and unfairly dislikes other people, ideas, etc. So when someone calls you a bigot, they bear the burden of proof to tell you why you unfairly judged a people group or religion or anything like that. But they may also call you, perhaps, maybe to say, oh, you're intolerant. But they have to redefine tolerance to do that. Because if Beth and Rocky believe one thing and I believe something else, then that is my opportunity to be tolerant. Because if they believe what I believe, which is the case, then I'm not tolerating them, I agree with them. I tolerate people I don't agree with. So when someone calls you intolerant, they are just basically showing you their intolerance of you and your differing opinion or belief. Sometimes people may call you a racist, but Islam's a religion and not a race, so this doesn't even make sense, of course. So they may just say Islamophobe, but a phobia is something that is in your mind. And how can they control what you hate, what you love, what you like, what you don't care for? There's no way to get into someone's mind and force them to love something or hate something. And all the time when we see hate crimes against Muslims, which we should all condemn, we should condemn hate crimes against all people, they cry Islamophobia. But people did not just kick or hit or attack the religion of Islam, they hit or kicked or attacked a person, a human being, a person made in the image of God. So number one, it'd be better to label it Muslim phobia, because Muslim is referring to the actual person, not the ideology or the religion or the religio-political system known as Islam. So all of these four terms, which you'll probably get called, all do not make sense at the end of the day. And if you don't know the definitions of those terms, you cannot point those facts out to people either. So please study Islam, study Christianity, compare the life of Jesus and the life of Muhammad, and see the stark contrast between the two, because they do not teach in any way the exact same things. And people need to get informed about that, especially here in the West, where you have the Muslim Brotherhood and different political Islamists who obviously have a different method of operation than ISIS, and that's why they don't wind up on the nightly news like ISIS does. But the worldview is the same. They want the world to be under Sharia. ISIS wants it under Sharia. The Muslim Brotherhood and political Islamists want it under Sharia. The thing is that they have different timelines. ISIS wants a caliphate yesterday. The Muslim Brotherhood and political Islamists are willing to work on a long-term, incremental, methodical plan, and even if it takes multiple lifetimes of Muslims in order to bring that about. Now, here in the West, a lot of Muslims don't know about this plan, and they don't know that they are actually part of the overall agenda, just being part of the ummah in general. So people need to get very, very informed about it. So again, please watch the show again and share it. Please also watch my video, The Muslim Brotherhood, Origin, Identity, and Agenda, available on my Vimeo channel, vimeo.com/Tony Gurley, G-U-R-U-L-E. Also watch the other shows this week. watch on the on my Vimeo channel, I have the Islamization of the United Kingdom, which is exactly where Beth is. The United States has to look to that and say, okay, we can follow their mistakes or follow in their footsteps. I mean, you know, learn from their mistakes or follow in their footsteps. And every other country that is not under Sharia, that has not been Islamized yet, needs to know this as well. Because again, the worldview, the overall agenda of Islam is to have the world under Sharia. And jihad is a way that that is implemented, because under Sharia is how there can be no compulsion in religion, and you can not be under jahiliyyah, and you can make a free decision on if you want to become Muslim or not. With all of that said, I want to thank Beth and Rocky for being on this very informative show, and I want to give each of you a minute and a half to give a closing statement. What would you like to say that you haven't said so far, or what would you like to inform our audience about? Let me go to Rocky first, and then we will end with Beth.
Sure. I just want to reiterate that I love Muslims, that I am not against Muslims at all. My family is Muslim, and I love them deeply. And I love the people. I love the Middle Eastern culture. It's my culture. I love the food. I love the music. I love the history behind it all. I love it. And the reason why I accept your invitations, Tony, to come and to speak to women and to speak on these shows is because of my love for Muslims and my love for Muslim women. At the end of the day, when I had to research, when I had to find what which one is the true religion, which one was from God and which one was not from God, my eternity depended on it. And the eternity of all the souls that are watching depend on what we share and what we don't share. And I believe that Christ is the answer. I believe that the Bible is God's word. And I want to encourage the viewers who have not studied it to study it, like you said. And I want to encourage them to study Islam and to truly ask the questions that they need to ask, because at the end of the day, our eternity is dependent upon it.
Amen. Rocky, thank you so much for being on the show. I love to have you on. I love that you do me favors by coming on and showing the world how we do need to love and explain Christianity, love our Muslim neighbors. That's exactly what we all need to do. Beth, also, I want to thank you so much. I know you are very busy over there at Speaker's Corner in the UK on the front lines, and you are a wealth of knowledge, and I thank God for you. And every time that you can take time out of your very, very busy schedule to come on and do shows with me. What would you like to tell our audience in your closing statement?
As Rocky said, love Muslims, critique Islam. We don't hate Muslims, we love Muslims. We love the people. God loves the people. God died for the people. God died for me, he died for every Muslim. God thought of the Muslim when he was dying for them on the cross. And so we love those Muslims because they're made in the image of God, as Genesis tells us, and God died for them. We love Muslims, but it's the ideology, it's the theology of Islam we do not love. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says very clearly, for we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. That's why we critique Islam. So as the tagline along all the social media platforms of Fander, we say very, very clearly, and this is the challenge, I guess, to go out for all those listening to today, is critique Islam, love the Muslim, because God loves the Muslim. God does not love Islam, but he does love the Muslim, and we ought to love them too. That's why we do what we do.
Amen. Jesus Christ said, he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. If Jesus is the truth, and we should love the truth, even if we don't know it. I mean, everyone wants the truth. You know, no one appreciates lies. No one appreciates when people lie to them. Jesus is the truth. That means that any man-made religion that is in opposition to who Jesus Christ actually is a lie. And if Islam teaches different than Christianity and about a different Jesus, if Mormonism has a different Jesus, if Jehovah's Witnesses have a different Jesus, these are just different flavors of a lie. And they are all distractions from the truth. But come to the truth. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Look to the New Testament, read the words of eternal life that are only found there. And we hope that if you've not done so yet, that you would repent of your sins, turn from your sins, and put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is our prayer for all of you as you go out there, as you read the New Testament, read the Islamic sources. Please spread that information to other people, because all of us are on the same team, working together to share the truth, to share the gospel, to exalt the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, to reach the lost and equip the found. That's what we do here at ABN, the Training Channel. So please pray for us and please continue to support this network financially, which will allow these great informative shows to continue. God bless you, and we will see you on the next show.